that we're singing about, because we want to follow you. We want you to lead us, and we want to follow in the footsteps that you have placed for us. Be with us this morning as we worship and we give you praise, and as we learn from your word. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I move. I will follow. I'm not afraid.
introduce Pastor Doug Mingle. If you've been watching the last couple of weeks, you've seen him already. He gives great messages, and we're so thankful he's back again.
Grace to you, and peace from our Almighty God and from our Savior Jesus Christ. It is truly a joy to be with you, and thank you for drawing together with us in worship. And I am indeed blessed by more of the Potter's Band being with us today and bringing us into your holy presence, O God. And thank you for spending a few minutes with us, and I hope that you are blessed by what we share today. The text I will be speaking on this morning is found in the book of Joshua. In the 24th chapter, then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago, your ancestors, Terah and his sons, Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." But Joshua said to the people, "You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good." And the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." He said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." The people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God, we will serve, and him we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made statutes and ordinances for them at Shechem. Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak in the sanctuary of the Lord. Joshua said to all the people, "See, this stone shall be a witness against us, for it is heard all the words of the Lord that he spoke to us. Therefore it shall be a witness against you if you deal falsely with your God." Let us pray. Holy God, we are in awe of you. In marvelous ways you have brought us out of trouble into safety, out of bondage into freedom. With our whole heart, we want to serve you faithfully, following Christ, your Son. When we stumble and stray from your way, you call us back and forgive us. Help us to set all our hope on you, for your love never fails. Use us to help others in our community and across the world to know your great love. We ask this through Christ our risen Lord. Amen. Choose this day whom you will serve. Yeah, that's the sermon title for today. Choose this day whom you will serve. Is that a little too obvious? Do I really need to talk for 12 or 14 or 15 minutes about that? And maybe you're thinking that it's time for you to just go ahead and tune me out. After all, we have come to this moment together because each of us has made that choice already. Well, I couldn't let go that quickly myself, so you're going to have to bear with me while I share what is in my heart today. The first thing to notice is that Joshua presents serving the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Moses as a choice. Sure, God made promises to bless Abraham if he followed, but God never tried to compel him to follow. Abraham chose to believe and chose to trust and to serve the Lord instead of the gods he had known before. Moses chose to believe and chose to trust and to serve the Lord. And now Joshua says he is making that same choice. And he challenges his fellow Hebrews to do the same. And of course, whom to choose is important. You see, before Abraham had his first encounter with the Lord God Almighty, whom he left his family's land to follow, he and other people worshipped many other gods, whatever gods suited their needs in particular times and situations. He came to a moment where he chose to follow the God who called him. God who had decided that Abraham and his descendants were God's choice. So he left his father's land and the gods of his father to follow the one whom he had just met to an entirely new place. And that new place was both geographic and spiritual. And this brings to our minds the call that Jesus gave to the disciples who followed him. Beginning the day, he told some fishermen to leave their nets and come on an unknown journey. And though we might want to make a case for how irresistible the presence of Jesus just might have been, the fact is, he invited them to come. And they had to choose to RSVP with a yes and with their feet. And now comes the tricky part. We have a choice whom to follow. But this invitation to the people from Joshua is not merely about choosing to follow the Lord God Almighty instead of any number of other gods. The word he uses is not simply about following. In this case, his meaning, his call to them is clearly to not just get up and walk in the same direction. It's not just to worship and adore. It is clearly to serve. And for a people who had just been rescued from generations of brutal slavery, this is a hard thing to keep. God is not just a guide who leads them from Egypt through a wilderness to a new and better land, whose hand they will shake at the end of the trip, saying, "You've done such a good job for us. Thanks for everything. We've got to forget." There is more than gratitude in Joshua's voice. He says that he and his house will serve the Lord. Not just worship God, and not just thank God. He issues to them a challenge to become servants once again. And for a people who have finally escaped Egypt and were promised a land of their own, there must have been a great tendency for them to feel as if they had made, so to speak. Now they're being told that their lives with God would still be about serving. Still be about submitting. This time, however, it is the God who rescued them, the God who leads them, the God who feeds them and loves them and proclaims them to be God's chosen one, who is asking them to live in that relationship. In Egypt, they had no choice but to serve Pharaoh. Now they have a choice. Joshua says they can choose to serve other gods. Maybe the gods of their ancient ancestors or gods of the people whom they would encounter in the promised land, but he has chosen to serve. And he has chosen to serve the Lord. This is terribly challenging for us. To not be masters of our own lives and our own fates is really, really difficult. So much of survival in this world becomes dependent on our being strong, about having our wits about us, about taking care of ourselves. If we let down our guard for a moment, then somebody will take advantage of us or take everything from us. It's hard to keep the big picture in focus. You know, the one about completing God's creation by redeeming all of God's children, by welcoming them all home, and oh, by the way, using ordinary folks like Peter, Andrew, James, John, and us to spread the word. So here we are, as followers of Jesus, still struggling with what Joshua's challenge means. We're not only unsure how to serve, most of the time we're not even of the mind to serve. We wear religion like a badge or like a comfortable pair of shoes. We use what we know about Jesus to tell others how wrong they are instead of that they are forgiven. We think we have it made, and we confuse faith with knowledge. It is no wonder that Joshua repeats his challenge to the people three times and tells them that he is sure that they can't really do what they say they're going to do. Just like when Jesus asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" Joshua allows them to affirm their commitment to serving God before joining them in a covenant-making ceremony, writing down the words, setting up a stone as their witness. And they must decide. Choose this day. There's quite a sense of urgency here, isn't there? This is truly an important point in their journey away from Egypt into their journey to be God's people. The point at which they have to decide if they will accept God's invitation to be God's people on God's terms. Choose this day. We need to make the choice today, and we need to make this choice every day. In a sermon he gave on February 4th, 1968, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, quote, "Jesus gave us a new norm of greatness. If you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's your new definition of greatness. And this morning, the thing that I like about it, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great, because everybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and your verb agree to serve. You don't have to know about Plato and Aristotle to serve. You don't have to know Einstein's theory of relativity to serve. You don't have to know the second theory of thermodynamics in physics to serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love, and you can be that servant." Unquote. Joshua and Dr. King remembered what we read in Genesis 12:2, that God had told Abraham, "I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing." The life that we enter when we choose to serve the Lord God Almighty is still the same as that. The blessing that God brings to us is so that we can give it to others, to serve God by sharing what he has given to us. There is more to our choice than a big dinner, a litany of life's blessings and plentiful, happy, thanksgiving wishes. It's not enough to simply worship, saying, "Thank you, Lord, for everything. We'll take it from here." No, Jesus will take it from here. So choose this day whom you will serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love, and you can be a servant. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy One, in theory we know you love each one of us. Teach our hearts how much you really do love every other sinner on this planet. Not just the believers, but also the unbelievers, and not just good folk, but also the very bad. Receive our prayers for the many kindly people we meet each week, at work and in the street, at sport and at the theater, in service groups and committees and agencies that fight for the rights of the needy and the exploited. Receive our prayers for the many awkward people we meet, the painfully shy, those who are always complaining, the quick-tempered, and those who don't seem to be aware when their words and actions hurt others. Receive our prayers for the people we thoroughly dislike, for the manipulators who try to use us, the loudmouth whose language disgusts us, the greedy who are out to cheat us, the strong who try to bully us, the cruel whose deeds horrify us. Receive our prayers, O Lord, for the people who are easy to like and to love, the generous ones, the ones who keep their good humor when under pressure, those who volunteer for difficult tasks, those who bear no grudges. And receive our prayers for those who dislike us, one-time friends who turn against us, folks at work who make things unpleasant, relatives who try to put us down, neighbors who make a nuisance of themselves, and people who go out of their way to ridicule Christians. Receive our prayers for all who are miserable today, any who suffer from depression or acute anxiety, any who have just received bad news about their health, people who have been spurned by loved ones, many who are hungry, homeless, imprisoned, drug addicts who can't break free, for the dying and the grieving who have no one to comfort them. Holy One, please may the hands of Christ be upon all of these people and on the millions whose misery is far beyond our knowledge. Lead this world away from all that is maimed and is maiming, from all that is degraded and is degrading. Hasten the day when we shall walk in the promised land, where Christ's love and joy is everywhere. We pray in his name and for your glory. Amen.
We're going to end today's service with the blessing.
Children, their children, their children.
grace and your mercy. Thank you for your love. And we thank you for your intervention that's going on in the world right now. We know, Lord, that you know the beginning to the end. Lord, so put our hearts at ease, Father. Be with each and every one of us. Fill our hearts with you. We love you and we praise you, Lord, forever. In Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.